All right, we're here at the Cranbrook Institute of Science, here for to set up and get ready.
I collect all of my eggs from our display tank. The majority of it is from our 85,000 gallon system. But mostly I use egg collectors that I build out pretty much anything depending on the size of the tank. So that one over on the left there is made from a plastic critter keeper that people use to hold crickets and whatever else, little animals. Pretty much you just have a bulkhead with a lift tube inside of it, driven by air that pulls water in from the outside tube, and it pulls in the eggs and whatever else in the water column, and then the water is able to go out and the eggs get trapped in. Your larval rearing. You can get real creative on what you use to do larval rearing. As I said, the main go-to are black round tubs. These are tubs that Andy from Roger Williams designed. If you're working with a lot of egg layers, you go out to staple against some transparency foam. Last year, I was able to raise live tail anthias. These guys were pretty interesting. The system that I was working with was the tide pool. That was a challenge for me because I was only able to collect a couple hundred eggs rather than a couple thousand with the other fish larvae. They're cannibalistic. So since I was collecting such small numbers, I would put several days worth of eggs into a larval tank. And the larger one is 39 days old, and the one that's getting eaten is about 30 days old. So I'm excited to try to work on all this stuff, and these are some great sites to go to and get more knowledge when you can't gather in a group like us and talk face to face.
If I can't get wild caught, then I usually try to find a source that has a good breeding program and as close to F1s as possible. And we go with as high of a rate as we can go comfortably, depending upon the species and the size of the fry after feeding, so that we flush out the food, typically Artemia rotifers.
And African flamebacks. here's some of the African plainbacks. These are about 1.5 inches long. This is a video taken last week. Tank full of mostly lemon eels. I think there are a few, maybe a few African plainbacks in here. And here's some of the green angelfish. As far as we know, this is the first time that this specific species has been raised in captivity. So some pictures here in the video, courtesy of Colby Johnson. Thank you for those. I lifted them off his site. So one of the questions we've had, Jake Adams, who writes for Reef Builders, actually said, why would you even have green angelfish broodstock? So one of the answers is we have good access to those. We have a supplier in Sri Lanka that sends us very healthy fish, and we have green angels coming through the SI project regularly. So it was kind of a species of opportunity. If this is going to be possible, we should try it because we have these available. But the other reason is that it's kind of a proof of concept species, or I call it a gateway species for the genus. So there's some other very attractive fish in this genus that are rare or hard to find, are very attractive. So the angels are, we're really excited about those, and that's been a big challenge, and we plan to continue doing that. The tangs were kind of the one that started the Pelagic Spawner Project when we started that about 5 years ago. So this is what we've done so far, and as far as we've gotten with the blue tang.
We go off of determining their sex based off of size. So for that, we use standard length, and we determine that males, we consider males either equal to or greater than 4.5 centimeters. But as you can see in here, this is a male brown who is actively taking some of the catamorph algae and going and building his own little nest. So the male will come out of the nest here, and then you'll see that there it goes and does a small quiver. And I'll play that again real quick because it's kind of fast. But out it comes, and there's a little quiver, swims away, and then we'll go back towards the nest. So out of all these graphs, basically, conclusion of it is that the one male to one female ratio and the one male to two female ratio seems to be more beneficial.
So why quarantine? It kind of goes without saying, but I really think that quarantine can be considered the best, easiest, cheapest, like highest return on investment in our industry. Good gills are first and foremost on the list. Everything in a fish's physiology of his life revolves around the gills. But there are ways to deal with these things. My absolute favorite, and by far the most applicable to ornamental breeders, is going to be the tank transfer method. It is just a bulletproof method of eradicating almost every disease we're talking about here. But then I hear this all the time, but I can't afford it. And I just said, because most people that tell me that are buying Band-Aid angelfish. And I'm like, so dude, you're gonna spend, you know, $2,000 on an angelfish, but you won't buy a $200 microscope. The take-home message, try and buy your fish from a good source. Try and figure out what the fish have been through, how they've been quarantined. Maintain the shortest supply chain that you possibly can. You know, the less travel, the less transmission, the better. Plan ahead for disease. Keep records, gather data, don't give up, and that's it.
Ha ha ha.